Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for our presentation, Library Structures as Sites to Rethink, Using Established Workflows to Open a New Understanding of EDI Unit Culture. We work in the Learning and Engagement Services Unit, or department, at Utah State University Libraries, and we are located in Logan, Utah. My name is Katie Strand, and I am the library's first-year experience librarian. My pronouns are she, her. I'm joined today by my colleagues, Dori Rosenberg, Jessica Sandberg, and Aaron Davis. Today, we are exploring how we can rethink the structures and processes that encompass our work as academic library staff in order to promote positive change. As we engage in these conversations, we must remember that racist ideologies and practices were used in creating our systems of higher education and that they are still persistent today. In considering our context as a land-grant university, an important part of this work is also acknowledging the painful history of genocide and forced removal of Indigenous peoples that facilitated the founding and maintenance of Utah State University. We acknowledge that USU and all in-state USU institutions reside on the original territory of the 8 federally recognized tribes of Utah and other groups who have been living, working, and residing on this land from time immemorial. These tribes are the Confederated Tribes of the Goshute Indians, the Navajo Nation, the Northern Ute Tribe, the Northwestern Band of Shoshone, the Paiute Indian Tribe of Utah, the San Juan Southern Paiute, the Skull Valley Band of Goshute, and the White Mesa Band of the Ute Mountain Ute. Land acknowledgments find power in the actions that they inspire. As information professionals, our daily actions and decisions impact who is silenced and who is heard. This can be seen in the resources and materials we choose to include or not include in our collections. In honoring and respecting the Indigenous peoples still connected to the land on which we speak to you today, we'd encourage you to consider adding Mr. Darren Perry's book, The Bear River Massacre, A Shoshone History, to your library collections. Mr. Perry is the former chairman of the Northwestern Band of the Shoshone Nation, and his work brings a perspective that needs to be heard. Our library is currently working on crafting a land acknowledgement that is specific to our institution and geographical region. And in a recent library workshop where Mr. Perry spoke, his words called upon us to rethink our concept of what a library is. He shared that in the settler mind, land was property, real estate, capital, or natural resources. But to our people, the land was everything: identity, connection to our ancestors, the home of our non-human kinfolk, our pharmacy, our library. While Mr. Perry was speaking in a historical context, his words apply today. Given his people's emphasis on oral history, he also shared the powerful idea that when an elder dies, a library burns. For us, Mr. Perry's words reiterate the need to reframe the meaning we place on our physical and procedural structures and to consider how we can shift our current practices to support equity, diversity, and inclusion in our libraries.
We'd like to continue by sharing a bit more about USU. Utah State University is a predominantly white institution. In fall 2019, a number of campus climate surveys were administered, in part to compare USU to peer institutions. And in 2020, the findings were released. Here is a table that shows student and faculty demographics from those survey results. The two columns highlighted in blue represent students, and the orange columns are faculty. The results show that USU has a higher percentage of students and faculty that are white in comparison to our peer institutions. However, USU also has a higher percentage of both Latinx and Native American students and faculty. Also, while Asian or Asian American representation in our student body is slightly above our peers, representation from this group in our faculty is quite lower. And the number of Black students and faculty at USU is far below our peers. It's important to remember that these numbers are based on survey results. However, I think they can still help us understand USU's current makeup. We are four white women at a predominantly white institution, and while we are dedicated to this work, we are not experts. We'd like to recognize that there has been an immense amount of labor done by our BIPOC colleagues here at USU and in our profession at large. And that equity, diversity, and inclusion is our work as white librarians too. In fall 2019, Dr. Noelle E. Cockett, the first female president of our university, demanded that our institution do better. In her presidential priorities that were released that year, she calls for an increase in the diversity of students, faculty, and staff, and the promotion of inclusiveness and respect across the USU community. In response, each unit in our library was asked by our dean to identify how they would start to further these priorities within their areas. Administrative offices across the university offered a bunch of professional development at this time on topics like upstanding, implicit bias, and microaggressions. We were excited that these conversations were gaining greater momentum. However, there was also still some frustration that these sessions felt a bit like a one and done deal. We knew that USU and our library needed to do more. Along those lines, our session today will probably be most useful for those of you that are also experiencing slow institutional change. Or if you're wanting to see examples of how librarians at a predominantly white institution are trying to use scaffolded professional development to influence unit culture and inform meaningful action. As teaching librarians, we wanted to center our work in conversations surrounding critical information literacy. In the practice and promise of critical information literacy, academic librarians' involvement in critical library instruction, Eamon Toole describes critical info lit as not being just limited to instruction. Instead, it is a way of thinking about information literacy as a whole as it is expressed across sites. Critical info lit has much to offer librarians seeking to rethink not only their approach to instruction, but also the goals and actions of libraries more generally. And in thinking upon our work over the past 2 years, what we've really tried to do, as Toole describes, is rethink those goals and actions of our unit and how we can use them to continually make our library a better place to work, not only for our current staff, but also for those that will join us in the future. In structuring our time with you today, we'd like to revisit our intended learning outcomes. Our goal today is for attendees to first identify some established structures, workflows, or documentation within your library unit for targeted EDI integration. Second, to develop one possible goal connected to that established structure in your unit. And third, to be able to describe 2 to 3 EDI professional development activities that you could perhaps try locally. To that end, we will be sharing our thoughts in 3 different parts, with each section ending in an individual reflection component. First, we'll speak at the unit level. This section will feature some professional development trainings and selected projects within our unit that were influenced by our goal process. Second, we'll pause and we'll focus at an individual level so that you can start to see how this work is also manifesting within or beyond our team. And third, we'll facilitate a collaborative discussion using the Padlet platform on barriers and opportunities related to this work, as well as some of our steps moving forward. Also, throughout this presentation, we'll have some reflective moments. So please get a piece of paper and a pen or pencil out or a Word document up.
Our unit, Learning and Engagement Services, which we'll refer to as LES, includes 11 faculty librarians, 2 teaching assistants, and 3 student workers that hold the title Library Peer Mentors. Our unit houses our library subject liaison program, as well as our web services librarian. We are active partners in teaching and learning related to InfoLit, and we support faculty and students by providing expertise across the curriculum and at the point of need. This includes offering services that reach all of our users, regardless of location, by providing robust online learning materials, strategic in-person instruction as possible, and easily accessible information via our website. There is a broad range of time that individuals have spent within the unit. Some members have been with us for less than a year, while others have been with the unit for well over 15 years. One of the structures that we've drawn upon to promote productive collaboration and respect within our unit is our yearly summer retreat. Every year, each library unit plans an individual goal-setting retreat in late summer to reflect on the past year and to decide on upcoming goals. The LES unit typically identifies 3 to 5 major goals and then creates working groups that lead the efforts on each of those goals for the unit. In summer of 2019, our library dean distributed a guiding strategic plan priority document for all staff to keep in mind throughout each unit's retreat. Within this document, one of the major priorities identified was working on a diversity, equity, and inclusiveness plan for the library. And each unit was tasked with discussing EDI unit retreats. With a focus on broadening our thinking, as tools suggest, we needed to rethink the goals and actions of our unit. Let me briefly outline our retreat experience for you in these next couple slides. A few weeks leading up to the last summer retreat, we spent time at a unit meeting responding to the following focus statement under the direction of our unit head. Our unit has the greatest impact when it is student focused. Some of the questions that came up in our corresponding discussion were, why student focused? Only students? What about faculty? Are all patrons students? Can we approach being student focused in many different ways? How do our campus partnerships impact our goals? This activity was meant to help us think about our impact, our identity, and how we might think about our work more holistically as we generated our goals. In addition to the focus statement, we were asked the following question prior to the retreat. What events, documents, initiatives, or circumstances might impact our goal development in the coming year? We found that having to compile a list of external factors ultimately guided us towards EDI, becoming an important way that we naturally initiated EDI conversations in our unit. For example, many of us drew upon our president's initiatives to foster more inclusivity on our campus, priorities and actions related to social justice for campus partners, our library's strategic and assessment planning documentation, and our support of the Black Lives Matter movement. During the actual day of the retreat, we facilitated our discussion using strategies such as Think Pair Shares and the Circle of Voices structure. In the Circle of Voices structure, each participant received 1 to 2 minutes of uninterrupted time to share their thoughts. After collaboratively brainstorming some possible unit goals, we used the Circle of Voices structure to give individuals time to share how they saw the drafted goals relating to their roles and/or interest. Based on our discussion at the retreat, we identified 4 major goals, with the following connected specifically to EDI. Our unit wanted to explore the EDI needs of students to identify opportunities and improvements in our instruction. And we wanted to explore some possible next steps for expansion into other areas of our work, including info desk support, interactions with student workers, and our web presence.
The 4 of us here today volunteered to serve on the EDI working group that led this work for our unit. While we always kept connections to students in mind, we found that our goals shifted and we needed to first foster conversations on understanding what EDI means for our team. As a result, we facilitated a number of scaffolded professional development opportunities, either during our recurring unit meetings or as a scheduled workshop. The following is a timeline of our process, and we'll highlight some activities from our discussions. In August 2019, our working group convened. In December 2019, we held a half-day workshop. In January 2020, we ordered posters for our spaces. In February 2020, we held a training around our foundational teaching principles. And in June 2020, we held a microaggressions training. While we focus our activities on instruction, each of the following activities could be tailored to other areas of library work. I'll now go into more detail about the timeline. In August 2019, our working group was convened and we began by reviewing the literature in connection to EDI-related conversations and instruction. As a result of our literature review and the related conversations we'd had in our working group, we wanted to hold a half-day workshop in December 2019 focused on developing a shared understanding of EDI work and how it connects to our interactions with our patrons. We spent about 2 months carefully thinking about what we wanted this workshop experience to be like and what we wanted our learning outcomes to be. The learning outcomes we selected were that we wanted our colleagues to discover techniques they could immediately apply to model EDI best teaching practices, start conversations on equity, diversity, and inclusion within our unit, feel uncomfortable in a good, productive way in order to create empathy and inclusiveness in our work environment, and to identify a goal or something small we could each do in the near future to practice EDI teaching principles. In support of those learning outcomes, we facilitated several activities, one of which we'd like to pause and work through together. This brief activity is focused on individual reflection and doesn't necessitate sharing out. I'll share a prompt on the screen that I'll read out loud, and I'll give you about 10 seconds to reflect on your answer in your own head, or you can write it down. So here is your prompt. Who do you picture when you hear the word student? Okay, so what image popped into your head? When we first did this activity, I immediately thought of a blonde white girl about my height at the information desk. In other words, someone kind of like me. With this short activity, all of us began thinking about the impact of implicit bias in our work. As we facilitated a follow-up conversation with our colleagues, several opened up about their reflections, and we had a powerful conversation about calling out our own biases in our unit's work and interactions with patrons. During the workshop, we had a presentation from Cree Taylor, who was one of the graduate instructors within the composition program at the time, but is now a lecturer. Cree's personal research and thesis focuses on race talk in the classroom. In her presentation, Cree discussed why race talk is important and what it can look like in a library instruction session. Cree's presentation led us to concrete actions or ways we could apply our more abstract EDI principles, such as including diverse source types, using inclusive examples in library lessons, recommending alternative views to students researching a topic, and encouraging students to look at research angles that speak to race, gender, sexuality, and class. This is especially evident in our current instruction for the English composition program, which we will talk more about later. She also shared ways she has been crafting representative research opportunities for her students. Another activity we did was lead a reflection where we asked librarians to think about different inclusive strategies they've tried or have seen in various teaching contexts and write them down on massive sticky notes. So we could try some teaching principles, we could create some teaching principles based on the literature and their ideas. Collaborating with our colleagues helped us feel, all of us feel involved in this work in our unit. As a result of this half-day workshop and discussion with our colleagues, we did three things. We found ways to reaffirm our commitment to EDI in our spaces, we created a foundational teaching principles document, and we held other requested trainings during unit meetings. One project that came out of our first workshop was that our unit wanted our classrooms, consultation rooms, and office spaces to use visuals as a way to reaffirm our teaching principles and commitment to EDI. As a result, in January 2020, our working group led a project on finding and purchasing posters with inclusive messaging that we placed in targeted locations around our work areas. At this same time, we used the inclusive teaching strategies that were brainstormed in our half-day workshop, as well as our research, to inform the development of our unit's foundational teaching principles. This document started off being multiple pages, however, we slimmed it down to one page. It states that in our teaching, we want to be welcoming by modeling vulnerability, establishing expectations, and amplifying student voices. Be open by questioning assumptions, using EDI-related examples, and embracing EDI teaching moments. And be caring by incorporating student reflection, engaging in personal reflection, and continuing to learn. In February 2020, we then facilitated a discussion using our foundational teaching principles document with our unit and how it could inform our teaching moving forward. This is a document that we continue to reference and use today. There are lots of resources out there that talk about best practices, but what made this document meaningful for us is that it was developed through a process of collaborative learning and was created within our institution's context. Soon after our foundational teaching principles training, the pandemic started, and we decided we wanted to facilitate one more learning opportunity before the fiscal year turned over. In June 2020, based on some frustrations that had been felt during the university-wide training that was given to library staff, we wanted to craft an opportunity to think about microaggressions in the context of our instruction work. We used a virtual unit meeting for this discussion and structured the bulk of our time around guided teaching scenarios and applied two different models of responding to microaggressions, the action model and the six-step model that you can see here. A lot of the content in the training was based on Daryl Dwing Sue's book, Microaggressions in Everyday Life. One major takeaway we found is that by scheduling these professional development opportunities throughout each semester, our colleagues started bringing up related issues in all of our conversations. So by integrating a targeted learning into existing structures like unit meetings, we were able to create a ripple effect where EDI was emerging in conversations and projects across our unit. One strong example of this ripple effect is the work our first year experienced librarian, Katie, has led in coordinating our instruction with the university's composition program.
One of our unit's strongest partnerships is with the English Composition Program, where we integrate library instruction into the first and second year English Composition courses, which are our English 1010 and English 2010. Jessica and I are two of the three-member library composition team that coordinates our unit's work with the composition program. We take a programmatic approach and we spread the workload across the unit, ensuring that each composition section is partnered with a librarian. Many instructors in the composition program have traditionally drawn upon inclusive pedagogies to varying degrees in their teaching. And with the hiring of a new composition program director in 2019, the program is beginning to ground its work in social justice. In addition to professional development for instructors that prioritizes anti-racist learning, inclusivity is also written into the assignments and course outcomes. So for example, one of the program's information literacy outcomes asks students to incorporate a variety of texts and perspectives in their own research. One way that instructors are ensuring students achieve this outcome is by teaching students the importance of citing work by multiply marginalized and underrepresented scholars. Just like a lot of you, we were forced to transition our instruction online this past year due to COVID-19. Thankfully, our strong collaboration with the composition program and their focus on social justice created this unique opportunity for us to incorporate EDI more meaningfully into our library composition instruction.
Throughout summer 2020, we created multiple Canvas modules for the composition program, drawing upon our unit's foundational teaching principles. As we designed our investigating a topic module for English 2010, one of our learning outcomes was, students will consider their topic from multiple perspectives to understand how marginalized groups might be impacted, including looking at their topic through an intersectional lens. Within our investigating a topic module and all of our modules, we intentionally built in more representative examples, which is an established practice in the literature. For example, we begin our investigating a topic module with the broad topic of stress and college students. Throughout the module, as we ask students to consider underrepresented perspectives on the topic, we eventually arrive at the research question, what unique mental health and well-being challenges might LGBTQ+ students attending USU face, and how can the USU community better support them and all students? As students consider alternative perspectives within a broad topic, we also introduce them to the concept of intersectionality, demonstrating the nuance within individual perspectives and a given research topic. In our following synthesis module, we wanted to further students' consideration of alternative perspectives by asking them to look at who they are citing in their final research and what perspectives may be missing. Our hope is that students will understand that it's not enough to only explore the perspectives of marginalized groups when starting a research project. Students need to examine their research through the entire process to ensure that a variety of voices are represented in their paper. To this end, within the module, students fill out a synthesis matrix, and we expand the demonstration of our research topic by asking the students to include relevant resources. We realized that this content might be triggering for some of our students, so we also included advocacy and support resources within the demonstration. It's also important to note that whenever we create content for the composition program, we get feedback from them and implement it into what we created. They bring in great perspectives, and getting their feedback helps ensure that our library content will amplify what is being taught in their courses instead of being something that is an add-on for students. If you would like to know more about our Canvas modules for the composition program, you can go to the LibGuides for the English 1010 and English 2010 lessons. Again, we want to emphasize that all of this work with the composition program was possible because of the work we had previously done to learn more about equity, diversity, and inclusion.
Okay, so in this part one, we shared a little bit about how we've begun to explore some of our established structures in our unit to support meaningful and actionable professional development. So as a quick recap, examples of those repurposed sites were our annual goal process, recurring meetings, established relationships with campus partners like the English Composition Program, our physical office spaces, and targeted library curriculum. And we'd like to pause for a moment of reflection now and offer a chance for all of us to consider the following questions. What established workflows, documentation, or meetings does your unit or department use? And how might these established sites be used to further support EDI learning and action in your unit? So we'll play some music during this reflection session, and then once it's over, we'll continue. Thank you for taking the time to reflect there. We've learned that a crucial part of supporting EDI work in our unit is crafting time to listen to each other, share strategies we've tried in our different roles, and how our LES conversations and work are starting to connect to other areas across the library. And at this time, in the second section, we wanted to share some of those experiences, and I'll get us started. So I've been a faculty librarian at USU for 8 years. And in addition to serving as a liaison librarian for 2 departments, I've been the library's instruction coordinator for just over a year now. In efforts to more clearly articulate how I'm engaging with EDI work in connection to my various roles, I've advocated for making sure it's in my annual work plan. Now, admittedly, it's primarily shown up in connection to serving on specific task forces or committees, so I still have a ways to go in terms of thinking about this. But the benefit is that it provides an accountability component for myself and an opportunity to protect time and focus for this work. And since work plans are individually constructed between a library staff worker and their supervisor, this isn't a mandated approach. However, it's one way that I found I can use recurring documentation to support this work and keep it on the radar of administration. And as the instruction coordinator, I chair our instruction committee, which has been around now for about 3 years. And I oversee the development and revision of several foundational documents, including our committee's charge and our annual committee review. These documents are revisited each year and in that way are becoming a mechanism for targeted annual goal work. Given several changes to our instruction program and committee membership just over the last several years, a big part of our work this past year has been to come together as a new committee and start to decide how we want to shape our program and our documentation moving forward, especially in connection to our pedagogical approaches and how we can support each other since we're all coming from different departments across the library. And I am happy to talk in more detail about some of the stuff we've done with the instruction committee in the Q&A. With both of those examples, the caveat is that a program document or a work plan is really only as good or as useful as how they're applied and used. So my main takeaway is that if we can use the processes already in place that demand our attention, then hopefully we can maintain better momentum on EDI needs across the library.
As a staff member at our institution, I have very little formal power. I don't oversee any committees, I'm not a supervisor, and I have very little campus-wide experience. I do have some influence in the classes I interact with, but Katie is going to talk more about that. Although my influence in the library and at the university is minimal, I have the power to change myself and my personal sphere of influence. Over the past couple of years, I've done a lot of professional development. Our university held an inclusive excellence symposium that covered a variety of EDI topics that I attended. I've read several books, such as How to Be an Anti-Racist by Ibram X. Kendi and How to Be Less Stupid About Race by Crystal M. Fleming. I've watched a lot of webinars, such as this one, and I was part of an anti-racist reading group that turned into an anti-racist movie watching group. I've learned something new from every experience. The beauty of all of this is that if I learn something new, I share it with my husband and we have a discussion about it. For example, after watching Just Mercy for our anti-racist reading group, we had a great discussion about the death penalty and racism, which led us to developing a plan for how to respond when one of our family members makes a racist comment. One of the things we've decided to do when that happens is ask them questions to see if they understand what they're saying, and if they'd be open to hearing different perspectives. These experiences would not have happened if I wasn't focused on learning about equity, diversity, and inclusion. Overall, the personal and relationship development that has come into my life because I've learned more about equity, diversity, and inclusion has changed me and my work.
I have had several opportunities to bring our EDI work and ideas into my library and first year experience instruction. I'm incredibly fortunate to be able to collaborate with Cree Taylor through our instructor librarian partnership. Cree is an English composition instructor and also presented on her research during our half day EDI workshop. She challenges me and pushes me to more explicitly discuss social justice and EDI within the classroom. When teaching with her, we co-lead a brainstorming activity with the students that has us collectively thinking about new ways to narrow down a broad research topic. We often choose a generic topic, something like higher education, but we push students to consider that broader topic from the perspective of various identities, including race, class, gender, ability, sexual orientation, and education levels. It always results in students thinking about these topics in more inclusive ways and in ways that they are often overlooking. This activity actually inspired our work in the English 2010 Investigating a Topic module, where we ask students to consider their research from alternative perspectives. Cree also requires her students to think more critically about the authors and the voices that they are representing in their final papers, and to seek out marginalized authors when doing their own research. Helping her students with this has really allowed me to become more informed about the impact of citations and the importance of giving recognition to these marginalized and underrepresented experts. This ultimately led to Jessica and I, along with another colleague, creating a research guide about multiply marginalized and underrepresented scholars, how and why you should incorporate these scholars into your own research, and some tips and places to start when searching for work by marginalized scholars. The link to that research guide can be found at the bottom of this slide. I've often felt uncomfortable and inadequate when leading the library days in CREES classes, but I've experienced so much growth as an instructor and a librarian through our collaboration. For me, the EDI work in the classroom has very rarely happened when I have felt 100% prepared or perfectly versed in these discussions. I don't think that that perfection really exists, as this is something that requires constant learning and engagement, along with a substantial amount of vulnerability.
I've been a faculty member at USU for 15 years now. As a new unit head, I try to think about ways to influence positive change in the ways I structure meetings, in the questions I ask, and in the workflows I create. To me, it's about moving from having good intentions to being more intentional. One way I've been working to bring EDI work into specific library processes and documentation is working with our library administration on creating an EDI best practices document for library job searches. This document is a positive step towards moving our institution towards a better recruiting and hiring process. There is still a lot more work to do, but it's a start. In my work with our statewide campuses, I advocate for access to resources and services to all of our students and faculty studying across the state, regardless of location. This is especially true for several of our campuses that are located in rural areas, with one campus mainly serving Native American students, many of whom don't have access to electricity or running water when they go home to the reservation on the weekends. Building on the success of our library peer mentor program at the Logan campus, I advocated for funding for a similar peer mentor position at the Blanding campus. Although there is a physical library and staff of librarians at that campus, we found from usability studies that students weren't accessing the library as fully as they could and rarely asked for help from the librarians there. We've now been able to offer this position for 2 consecutive years now, and have been lucky enough to hire 2 Native American students each time. Since hiring our Blanding LPMs, our library there has been used by more students. So now we'd like to pause for a moment of reflection and ask you to consider what structures are within your individual sphere of influence. You can ask yourself, what established workflows, documentation, or meetings do you contribute to? How might you use these established sites to support or further support EDI learning in action in your own work? You have until the end of this short song to reflect.
As you can see, our library structures provided us with many opportunities for EDI learning and action, but we have experienced barriers as well. Just as our library has been facilitating conversations and shifting our work to better support EDI, other areas across our library have as well. For example, our acquisitions department has been pursuing and purchasing more diverse and inclusive databases and general collections, while our special collections department is leading conversations about archival silences. 2 of the biggest challenges we now face are making sure professional development informs meaningful action and figuring out how to better understand and connect all the work that has been happening across the library. Many of us have experienced a slight disconnect as we begin those cross-departmental conversations and collaborations. It can be difficult to facilitate and have productive conversations when our experiences and our comfort levels are much more varied across the entire library. There's even more of a disconnect with these conversations due to the pandemic. As the library, our library is actively working to unify our EDI work. While it is yet to be coordinated, one idea being considered is to hold a library inclusivity forum, where each unit would be able to share the conversations and work they've engaged in related to EDI. In fall 2020, our library dean also convened an EDI interim task force with two primary goals. The first being to initiate training and conversations surrounding the development of a library land acknowledgement. And second, craft an internal survey that library administration is currently using to better understand how the library's current policies and practices are either hindering or supporting equity, diversity, and inclusion. We're also at a major turning point in that our dean will be retiring this summer. How and when that position is filled will definitely impact this work moving forward. We would now really love to hear from all of you. So if you could please pull up this URL to access our Padlet, it's just bit.ly/EDI opportunities. We would really appreciate you all spending 2 minutes reflecting and sharing potential opportunities that you have identified at your own institutions for EDI learning and action, and some potential barriers that you might face.
We'd like to close by acknowledging that there is a lot of work ahead for our university, our library, and ourselves as individuals. However, we are looking forward to the many different ways this work will continue to evolve in our campus community. We'd like to invite you to join us for one more moment of reflection. Based on what we've shared and your own reflections, what is one action or takeaway that you'd like to remember or make happen after this session? In the Q&A, we look forward to answering any specific follow-up questions and also learning about what all of you are doing at your institutions. Thank you for your participation.